Alrighty, we are at season 10, class 10, the wrap up. So let's pray. Father, we thank you that you are a wonderful, good, good Father. We welcome you, we welcome your presence, and the more that you want to pour out on us tonight. Thank you for your goodness. And I heard talking. Thank you, Jesus. So Lord, we just thank you that you go before us this night, that the fullness of your plan and purpose would prevail. And I pray, Father, just for the thoroughness of the wrap-up, I pray that you open our eyes and ears and prepare our hearts, Father, as we go into the dream interpretation time, that everything out of the dreams that you want us to see tonight. So prepare us, prepare everyone watching online, and we just thank you for this time. In Jesus' name, amen. So, my notes are ready to jump into the dream interpretation time because that is what I'm dreaming about. We have some incredible dreams tonight. So in order not to get mixed up. So tonight we're doing a wrap up. What is the first thing I mention about dreams and dream interpretation? What's the first verse as a little prompt there? Genesis 40, verse 8, which is, do not interpretation of dreams belong to God. Please tell me your dream, because the Spirit of the living God is within me, so therefore I am able to interpret dreams. We all are, all who have the Spirit of the living God. And Proverbs 25, 2 is also probably our go-to number 2 verse as far as, and what's that verse say?
The glory of God to conceal a matter, the glory of kings to search it out.
Yes, and I love that God likes to hide things, and he likes for us to search it out. He likes to reveal his secrets. Mm-hmm. I love that he has secrets because we all, I mean, growing up, when you were a kid and someone told you a secret or you told someone, it was to be kept. It was precious. So for God to tell us his secrets and unveil them to us, it's a pretty, pretty cool thing. So going back to the first class, first thing I usually say is a third of the Bible is dreams and visions. And guess what? We spend a third of our life sleeping. But does God ever sleep? No. So he always has something on his mind, and, you know, so he wants to download that even in our sleep. And he loves us so much that he loves to draw us in even while we're sleeping. He's calling us. I think David said somewhere, I'm asleep, but my heart is awake. And just to have that tenderness and that, just to have that spirit that's always listening for God, I pray that for us. It's a powerful thing. Let's see. Yeah, dreams are night parables. Let me put my glasses on. Yeah, dreams are night parables that have secrets we can unlock. Over and over, God encourages us to seek to understand. Matthew 7:7 says, ask, seek, and knock. Ask and it will be given you. Seek and you'll find. Knock and the door will be open to you. That God has secrets, but he wants to show us those secrets. He wants to unveil those secrets to us. I was going over all these dreams, or all these verses of dreams, and how to turn them into declarations, and which I'll post on the site. I didn't quite get done with it, so I will finish it up and post it. And on the sheet, I have Genesis 40, verse 8. So like we were saying, that the scripture says, does not interpretation of dreams belong to God? Please tell me your dream. So to make that a declaration, that would be good too. A declaration, you say, thank you, God, that interpretation belongs to you, and thank you that the Spirit is in me, and so I can correctly interpret any dream that someone has that you want me to interpret. So you turn it into a declaration. And then Proverbs 25, 2, it's the glory of God to conceal a matter, but the glory of kings to search it out. Lord, thank you that you've put in me a searching heart. I want to search out every mystery, every secret, to understand the dreams that come across my path. And I thank you that you help me do that. And then in Daniel 2, verses 20 through 24, and 26 through 30, God reveals deep and secret things. These verses are just so powerful. I love the book of Daniel, and I encourage you to read that over our break, because Daniel was an incredible dream interpreter. So Daniel 2, verses 20 through 24 and 26 through 30. Says, Daniel answered and said, Blessed be the name of God forever and ever, for wisdom and might, power are his, and he changes the times and seasons. He removes kings and raises up kings. He gives wisdom to the wise and knowledge to those who have understanding. He reveals deep and secret things. He knows what is in the darkness, and light dwells with him. I thank you and praise you, O God of my fathers. You have given me wisdom and might, power, and I have now made known to me what we asked of you, for you have made known to us the king's demand. You've made known his dream. Down to verse 26. The king answered and said to Daniel, whose name was Belteshazzar, Are you able to make known to me the dream which I have seen and its interpretation? Daniel answered in the presence of the king and said, The secret which the king has demanded, the wise men, the astrologers, the magicians, and the soothsayers cannot declare to the king. But there is a God in heaven who reveals secrets, and he has made known to King Nebuchadnezzar what will be in the latter days. Your dream and the visions of your head upon your bed were these. As for you, O king, thoughts came to your mind while on your bed about what would come to pass after this. And he who reveals secrets has made known to you what will be. But as for me, this secret has not been revealed to me because I have more wisdom than anyone living, but for our sakes, who make known the interpretation to the king, and that you may know the thoughts of your heart. I love that section because what stood out to me today was God makes his secrets known. So with those, you can turn that into a declaration and say, thank you, God, that you make your secrets known. Here's this dream, make it known to me, you know. And so there's a whole lot you can declare there. And it also is a way, you know, just to worship and praise God in that verse 20. Blessed be the name of God forever and ever, for wisdom and might, power are his. It just goes on. And it says he gives wisdom to the wise and knowledge to those who have understanding. So Lord, make us wise. Give us wisdom. Grant us understanding. Those are just powerful. And Daniel, just like Joseph, Daniel walked in a lot of humility. You know, it wasn't made known to me because I have more wisdom than anyone living. It was made known to him basically to save their lives because the king had said, yeah, if someone can't tell me what my dream is, off with your heads, all of you, all y'all. So
yeah,
that was a, yeah, that's a time to be a good dream interpreter.
I feel like that makes it accessible for everybody too. Like it's not, Daniel was special, but I feel like by him saying that, it's like, okay, I can do this too. So
that's good.
It makes it, not only was he walking in humility, but it makes the dream interpretation as a whole accessible to anybody that wants it.
I love that. Yes. Yeah. So Lord, thank you that dream interpretation is, man, I have all kinds of words, acceptable to everyone. No, accessible to everyone. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, God. I just thank you that we can be put in that same camp as Daniel and the wise men, that's what I call him, and his wise friends. And then if we go to Matthew 13, verse 10, actually, let's start at 9. Whoever has ears, let them hear. The disciples came to him and asked, Why do you speak to the people in parables? He replied, Because the knowledge of the secrets of the kingdom of heaven has been given to you, woohoo, but not to them. Whoever has will be given more, and they will have an abundance. Whoever does not have, even what they have will be taken from them. But blessed are your eyes because they see, and your ears because they hear. So that's a powerful one too, that says he's given us the secrets of the kingdom. And interpreting dreams, practicing dream interpretation is a way to exercise that, that he who has more will be given. Mm-hmm. And I can attest to that because I've worked at dreams and dreams and dreams, interpreting them and over the years. And sometimes there was so many times where I just thought, you know what, it's just uncomfortable, you know. Sometimes someone tells you a dream, you're going, oh my gosh, what does that mean? And it's uncomfortable, it's overwhelming. But when I would pray and God in his faithfulness would show those secrets, it would just reignite me to go, oh, I've got got to do this. And whenever I would pray, Lord, you know, maybe I'm not a dream interpreter. Maybe I should move on to something else. I'm telling you, friends, family, strangers, friends of friends would email me, what does this mean? It's like, I don't know. But but God has a way of stretching you in order to grow you. So allow yourself to be stretched. Allow yourself, it's okay to say, you know what, can I get back to you on that? I'm not really sure. It's okay to say God really loves you. It's a really good dream, I can tell you that much. There's a house and it's about your life. So where in your life is God working? You know, but God's faithful. He'll give you the interpretation as you press forward in it. Alrighty, sources of dreams. Sources of dreams, they can come from ourselves, you know, especially in this day and age where we're constantly on our phones or watching TV or having the news or just being bombarded by information. We live in the information age and there's just so much coming at us. So we can have just busy dreams. And I told you one of my busy dreams is that I go to sleep and yet I'm just out on the ocean or sea being tossed about. It's dark, the waves are crashing around. I'm just trying to get to shore to dock the raft or boat. It's usually a raft. And so it took me many years. It seems so simple now, but God was basically saying, you're busy. You need to just quit striving and rest and trust. But now when I have that dream, it settles me down and instantly I go, okay, Lord, please forgive me for striving. Help me, you know, rest in you and seek you. What are you saying and doing? And get refocused and regrounded. So the dreams come from ourselves. They can come from the enemy. Sometimes you just have a dream where you're being chased or attacked or, you know, a nightmare, an evil dream. And that can come from the enemy. But God can use any dream. And so we talked about with the nightmares to flip them. And if you're being chased, to say, you know, in the name of Jesus, I'm only pursued by the Lord, you know, and I say no to anything evil that's trying to shut me down, shoot at me, take shots at me, all the things that those dreams, you know, put fear in me. I declare perfect love casts out fear. Thank you, Lord, for your love and your power, your sound mind. Doing a lot of declarations tonight if you haven't caught on. But I love it. I love that God's always about, you know, declaring his word because there's power and life in it, you know. So with a nightmare, and again, if you have any dreams that you're uncomfortable with or that are causing fear in your life, then please email them to dreamerslive411@gmail.com. See that far away look in my eyes as I like pull it in. What is that? So email them and we will help you flip them. We'll help you see what God can do through them, which is powerful stuff. So they can come from ourselves, they can come from the enemy. The best ones are the ones that come from God. And I love the ones where he calls us into his presence and we're on a mountaintop and there's clouds around and the colors are bright and there's a sense of joy and everything wonderful. Those are my favorite dreams. I've had a few. So those are basically the three sources: ourselves, God, and the enemy. The top 20 dreams plus. I put up the top 20 dreams on the site. So who can name five of them? Or let's just start yelling them out.
Flying.
What was that?
Flying.
Flying. Okay.
A car, vehicle.
X's. Cars or vehicles?
Yeah.
Dead relatives.
Births.
Naked
dreams.
Deaths. Yeah. What was that? Yeah.
Naked dreams.
Naked dreams. The infamous.
Dogs.
Or
alligators.
Snake.
Critter things.
Yeah, critter things. There, and there's several of them, so we can get a bunch there.
Being pregnant or birth.
Yes.
Shower.
Death. Bathroom dreams. Death. Yes.
Wallets and purses.
School. Chasing. We're learning something.
Chasing and being chased.
Yes. Water. How many have had dreams with water in them? Yeah.
One way or another. Different
teeth.
Teeth, yeah.
Those are my favorite. No, not my favorite, but I've had so many of them. That's probably.
Hair isn't,
but we did go over it before, so. And I've had a lot of hair dreams this fall.
Storms.
Storms.
Falling.
Falling. Feeling out of control. Yes. So that's a lot right there. So on the site, if you've lost your top 20 dream thing, it's there forever. So you can download it again. Metaphoric thinking. That's the next thing we talked about. Do you want to say anything about metaphoric thinking? What do you want to say, Mara?
What do I want to say? I don't know. Metaphorical thinking is Teresa's aspect.
Yeah.
It's not mine.
Yes, it is. Yeah, Teresa has a tremendous gift for metaphoric thinking. And one of the things, that why it's so important to think metaphorically, is I was doing a Bible study, and in the study, the author had said that her friend came to her, was really upset because she had a dream, and suicide was in the dream. And the author was really upset because she didn't have any, you know, she just said, I'll pray and stuff. But what suicide in a dream, metaphorically, is someone taking their own life, right? So it's someone cutting short their personal calling. And often, why would we do that? We feel inadequate, we feel unqualified, we feel like there's so many other people that could do it. And so to commit suicide in a dream would just be cutting off what, you know, it would just mean I'm overwhelmed and feel afraid of walking out who God has called me to be. You know, my identity, I don't want to be who I am. You know, all those types of things. And so when you can get the correct interpretation of what suicide is in a dream, it totally takes the power of what we think suicide means. So it's really important. And I just, when I read that in the book, I was like heartbroken. I thought, God, we need dream interpreters. You know, what's he say? The harvest is...
Yeah. Harvest is ripe, but the workers are few.
Yeah. So the harvest of dream interpretation is ripe. People are dreaming. What's that say about Joel? Or Acts 2, 17 through 18, or Joel 2, 28 through 29. In the last days, God said, I'll pour out my spirit on all people. All means all. That's everyone in the world. Your sons and daughters will prophesy. Your young men will see visions. Your old men will dream dreams. Even on my servants, both men and women, I will pour out my spirit in those days, and they will prophesy. So this is a season where the workers, we need dream interpreters, those that have the Spirit of the living God in them that can correctly interpret a dream, those that understand the language of God. Anything else on metaphoric thinking?
Could suicide also be you're ending the calling that you're in right now, but you're going to go to a new one?
It could be, but suicide is taking it into your own hands.
Yeah. Okay.
So that's the negative part of it. So it's a warning, and it's basically bringing it to light. Hey, do you realize this is what you're doing?
Okay.
So that you can, you know, wake up from a dream like that and say, oh my gosh, Lord, no, let me trust you.
Right.
Yeah, and turn it over. Yeah, so it would be very important that way.
Yeah, a metaphor is simply one word that can be substituted for something else.
Mm-hmm.
Definition of a metaphor, like our car is our ministry, and our house is our life.
Yes.
And a storm is... something disturbing in our life that we have to work through.
Mm-hmm.
And if we can see things, as you said, we can see things metaphorically, it takes the power away from it because it's not that thing. It represents something else.
Mm-hmm. Cool, yeah.
Okay, well, just thinking scripturally and stuff, I know that suicide by nature has a negative connotation. So does that mean it always has to be negative in dreams? Because I can think of like dying to yourself,
mm-hmm.
like the scripture talks about,
mm-hmm.
and I can see how maybe suicide could be depicting that.
Oh, so you're choosing it.
Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? So
yeah.
is it possible or is because suicide is just a negative thing in the natural, it's always going to be negative?
No, that would be a positive. If the whole dream was positive, the context would point to that. So that you're choosing. And that actually could be a dream where someone's stepping into the knowledge of who God is. Yeah. Yeah. Over in the corner saying, Lord, I know there's a positive spin on this.
Well, no, it's just kind of,
Yeah. So. Oh, no, that's good. Yeah, and I like, that's what God does. He like pokes and pokes until, you know, to keep us searching and looking into it. Were you going to say something?
Well, that's one of the things I really like about the metaphoric thinking is I feel like it's the whole Proverbs 25:2 about concealing matter, but it's kind of like, you know, when you have like your best friend and you have secrets and you can tell them just one word or even just that look. And they know. Mm-hmm. And like with your kids, you can, you know, like the whole parking lot rules thing. My kids knew that was like safe words. If they said those words, they knew that I would, that I would hold their hand or that they would be safe with me. And so for God to know that and to use those words on me,
yeah.
That whole metaphoric thinking is like, it's like his love language to us. It's like, I know how to talk to you and I know what matters to you.
Yeah, that's so good. I love it. Yes, and the parables that Jesus taught. You know, we were talking earlier about how Jesus was, but, you know, his character about just saying, it was like, you know, stretching their thinking. This is what it's like. The kingdom of heaven is like.
It's like he's telling us, he loves us enough to tell us, do we love him enough to figure out what he's saying?
Yes, yes. And it takes time. Dreams take time to figure out. And so it pulls us in to conversation. I remember when I was young, my mom would always say, do you want to go for coffee? This was like when I was in high school. And I mean, her and I were the only one in the house, but we would go out to a restaurant and have coffee and conversation. And that was always a really special time to me. And dreams are like that. God just, hey, here, what do you think of that? Do you want to talk about it? I'll show it to you. But he does look to see if we'll search it out. Because some people aren't willing to search it out, or some people just say, this is the way it is. This is how God speaks. And there's such a joy and a call into relationship with metaphoric thinking. You know, you can see the love and joy of a father pulling us in to say, let's talk. Dreams stir that up. Metaphoric thinking stirs that up. The next was colors and numbers in dreams. That's pretty self-explanatory. And that is, you can find on the Facebook Dreamers Live page in one of the resources. So if you're wondering about colors and numbers and dreams, go ahead and look that up. Again, one of the funny things this time is that I had really, you know, I've seen it so much that I was really emphasizing that numbers in dreams are usually a Bible verse. And so once I said that and taught that and stood on that, then God began giving me dreams where numbers actually meant 5 meant grace, 7 meant perfection. And so, don't put God in a box. He does not like it there. Or if you do, he'll just show you differently. So just obliterate it. And colors are important as well. In just showing detail and giving more understanding and feel for the dream. Dream interpretation keys. So I wonder what I meant by that. What did I teach you when I told you about dream interpretation keys? That's an excellent question to ask. The keys, of course, number one. What would I say keys mean tonight?
Well, keys probably, you know, usually if the dreamer, you know, usually the dream is about the dreamer.
Yes.
Probably it also has to do with the context of the dream and like the colors that are involved with it, that the, you know, specific connotations for that particular dreamer, like a dog to somebody who hates dogs, probably that dream is not going to be a positive dream, but a dog to somebody who absolutely adores dogs, probably going to be a really positive dream.
Good point.
Repetition.
Also common themes.
Common themes. And we've been seeing that a lot too, and we'll see that in the second half when a theme repeats itself in a dream. Pay attention to that. So, and what did you say again, Rose?
Repeated
things. Yeah, so if something's said over and over as well.
Yeah,
right. Yeah, those are keys. Good.
And whether it's dark or light, the
gives you context.
That you get in the dream.
Yeah, good. Anything else?
I'm looking for the 4 keys that Doug
had. I have it right here. The last one was interpret the dream in 3 to 4 sentences.
And I think, yes, keep it simple Always keep it simple so the person doesn't get bogged down in all your details. Because sometimes when we're interpreting the dream, it unfolds for us, and so we're like, ooh, and this, and this, and this, and this, and the dreamer's like, okay, that was good. I want to remember all that. So give them three or four things that they can sink their teeth into. And if they're writing it down, then you can just talk on and let it unfold. We were watching Dreams and Mysteries, right? That's what they're showing at the church on Wednesday nights here. And you can find it online at dreamsandmysteries.com. We're watching season two. We watched the first one. And at the end of it, John Paul Jackson interprets a dream. And I was noticing how he went on and on about the interpretation. Of course, he was prophetic too. So one of the things to notice about dreams is that sometimes when you're first stepping out in interpreting dreams, you might not get the interpretation correct, but God also has given us prophetic abilities so you can pick up on other things and still speak an encouraging word to the dreamer that will meet their spirit and touch them with God's power and love. And so it's win-win. But I like that. John Paul Jackson was a prophet, so he had both. And he really thoroughly interpreted the dream. But when we're first stepping out, that can be overwhelming. So just start with three or four sentences or even just a couple that are key to the interpretation. And sometimes, you know, I go back and forth on, you know, like I said, sometimes the dream unfolds. It's really cool. And I'm seeing different aspects of it. But sometimes I sense God is saying, just give them, you know, like a hook that will pull them in. And Proverbs 25:2, are they going to search out more? And so sometimes I feel God hold me back in my interpreting just to see if the person will search it out. And so that's something to keep in mind as well. These are extra things. But you'll kind of feel that. And it's also a way just to discipline yourself even, you know. I'm saying everything. That's discipline I need. Okay, questions to ask when interpreting dreams. Is it in the Bible? It's one of my favorites. And it's often, you know, that one wasn't something that was plain for me to see early on. I would get overwhelmed with the symbols and what they meant and trying to think metaphorically. But sometimes, you know, it's in the Bible. Keys are in the Bible. Doors are in the Bible. You know, there's all kinds of things in the Bible, clouds, mountains. There's all kinds of things that are in the Bible that will give you understanding into what the dream means. And remember, I had that dream where I was just looking down. My arms were strong and muscular. And I looked up arm, and it's in Psalm 118:32, I believe. But it basically means, the dream interpretation was that verse, that it is God who arms me with strength and makes my way perfect. And I thought, and so there I had a declaration, too. And it fit right into what God was doing in my life at that time. So check, you know, that's the first question to ask. What are some other questions? And that could bring up the repetition again.
Already at the top 20 in it.
Yes. Good. That's very good. That's such a good launching point is, because if you can get, if a few of the symbols are in the top 20, you've got some really strong keys to the dream right there. What else?
I'm reading the questions.
Okay. Go ahead. Let's read them off.
Okay. The first one, as you said, is it in the Bible? The second was, I'm sorry, my eyes. You read it. I can't read it.
Are there any common dreams or symbols like house, vehicle, da da da?
Top 20.
What are the possible metaphors? Are there repeated themes or words?
Yes.
Does the dream have any themes to compare or contrast? Example,
yeah.
Does the dreamer go from dark to light? Are there spoken words?
Spoken words are often key to the interpretation.
Right.
Yes.
What does the dreamer think the dream means?
That's my go-to when I, not so much anymore, but early on, when I find myself struggling. Or just going blank, then I would just start to ask that because that buys you more time, yeah. You know, for you to go, God, what does that mean? What does this, you know? And so you ask the dreamer. And a lot of times they have a sense of what it means or a key that they tell you.
And there's the common sayings like colloquialism, mm-hmm. I wasn't born yesterday, or play on words like Lion Man, Rite Aid.
Yes.
You want me to read them all?
No, you don't have to.
Okay. And then numbers like John 10:10, Jeremiah 10:10. What do the symbols, metaphors mean to the dreamer?
Like the dog, yeah.
And then the same word that has alternate meanings, like the current, as in river.
Current events.
Current events.
Yeah.
Remember, most dreams are about the dreamer. To think metaphorically, most dreams are symbolic rather than literal. Always leave the dreamer encouraged. Please be positive, flip negative dreams. And dream sources are God and you, Satan, and the atmosphere.
Oh, I forgot about the atmosphere. Yeah. Yeah, we're like antennas, so we can pick up stuff in the atmosphere.
Well, there's also, I mean, as far as sources go, there's also that whole chemically influenced dream.
Yeah, that's kind of a body dream, it's kind of you.
Yeah.
Yeah, and you can have the soul dream. You can break you down into a soulless dream, which is mean, I really, really want that. I really, really want that. I really, really want it. And then I dream that I get it. And so God is saying, you know, basically, are you sure you want that? I'll give it to you, but it's not my will for you. And so when God, whenever God says that, say, no. I have a couple of those in my life where it's like, yes, I really, really, really want it. And I got it, and I'm like, gosh, caused me so much trouble. So, yeah, so it can be your soul, your spirit, your body. Yes, so it's my husband, yeah. Yeah, it's interesting. Okay, dream types. That's the one that's always kind of a, and dream and chemical dreams kind of fit into that, body dreams. You can have a dream about your future. You can have a dream that kind of tells you where you are in your Christian walk. God's kind of saying, this is where you are, this is what's going on. He can give you an encouraging dream, what's ahead. He can give you, you can have literally a prophetic dream of what's going to happen, a revelation dream. He gives you understanding of something you didn't already know. I used to, like in the late 90s, early 2000s, I would often hear a word. All night long, I would hear the same word over and over, and I'd write it. Like, and a lot of them, I don't really understand what they mean. One of them was Anwar, and it was, there's something in Alaska about the, I don't know, it's up there with the oil and stuff. And I looked it up at the time, and I don't really know what it means, and I didn't really get understanding. One time I had a dream of subplant. All night long I heard subplant. Well, Jacob supplanted Esau. He took his birthright, so it's taking something that's not yours. And I kind of was in had some things going on in my life where I think someone was trying to do that in my life. Then I think I had a dream about acacia, which is a wood in the Bible. So these are all mysteries that I searched out and wrote up papers on, but I don't know if I had any real revelation. I had a dream, palladium. So they're all, I know, they're just strange. And recently, well, we'll get to that later. I had one recently anyway, we'll get to that in the next section. So, what else? Helpful things to remember. Always begin with prayer. That always goes back to the Genesis 40, verse 8. You'll hear me repeat that often, because it's so key. And as we went over the Daniel verses, I loved the Daniel ones because God basically says that he gave Daniel wisdom to interpret dreams as well. And then in the verse I read earlier where it says Daniel 2, verse 27, but there is a God in heaven who reveals secrets, and he's made known to the king what will be in later days. And then it goes down where it says, he who reveals secrets has made known to you what will be. And what I love is how Daniel is, in his humility, he says he's made it known to the king, but to the king it was a mystery. Daniel had to interpret it. And then God showed Daniel the secret. And then in verse back up, he reveals deep and secret things in verse 22. And my favorites, Daniel 1:17 and 19 through 20. And as for these four young men, God gave them knowledge and skill in all literature and wisdom. And Daniel had understanding in all visions and dreams. May we have understanding in all visions and dreams. Isn't that powerful? Like you said, it's accessible to everyone. Then the king interviewed them, and among them all, none was found like Daniel and his friends. They have names that are hard to pronounce. Therefore, they served before the king, and in all matters of wisdom and understanding about which the king examined them, he found them 10 times better than all the magicians and astrologers who were in all his realm. Isn't that powerful?
Mm-hmm.
So let's get this. Someone recently... Remember, Jesus said somewhere it is written, so I'm just like Jesus in that aspect. But someone recently prophesied that there's going to be Christian prophets on TV telling what's going to happen. There's going to be prophets speaking words to the kings, those in leadership positions. That's already happening. I've heard stories of people that I know that really walk, that as prophets, they really walk that strong and hear things that clearly where they've been, had opportunities to go before kings and leaders and speak God's messages to them. That's powerful. Mm-hmm. So, I don't, you know, years ago there was a president's wife who called a psychic or, you know, leaned on a psychic and different stuff. So, mm-hmm. we just say no to that, if you catch the point on that. But we say yes to God's truth coming through, because this shows God's people are 10 times better. That's pretty powerful. I think, and I believe that when they spoke in words like that, that basically means there's no comparison.
Mm-hmm.
There's no comparison from genuine and the counterfeit. The counterfeit is limited, like Satan. He's created. He takes up a certain realm of space. God fills the universe. There's no comparison in the genuine truth versus
yeah,
the...
Satan knows the scriptures, and he'll use them against us. So, you know, he's the accuser, and he'll... charges with all manner of things right out of the scriptures.
Yep, so that's why it's important to be in the Word. So that's a
that's
really
right.
good... And to be in the Word as a dream interpreter, because when you're interpreting a dream and something hits you, then you can add that, you know, as we go through our dream and verses come, that gives the dreamer tangible verses to declare, adding power and agreement to the dream.
I love the way that Jesus answered it back with scripture. When, mm-hmm. when during his temptation, when the devil would say something, Jesus would answer him right out of the Word and
yeah.
just shut him down, basically.
Yeah, truth. Truth is powerful. Yeah, and truth fills the universe. So yeah, it's possible to be 10 times better than anything. And like you said, the only strategy of the enemy is to magnify himself, make himself look big, and get our agreement.
Mm-hmm.
Don't do it. Don't agree with that stuff. Just say... You're not sure, I don't know, but I know God will tell me. Like Daniel and his friends, okay, boys, pray. You know, so we haven't yet been had that threat over our very lives.
Yeah.
But God is faithful. He'll to answer and give interpretations. Okay, we've talked about it. Most dreams are about the dreamer. Most dreams are symbolic rather than literal. The dreamer will have an aha moment when they hear a correct interpretation. Often you'll see it in their eyes. Often they'll cry. Sometimes I'm giving an interpretation, you know, going, I think this is it, and this and this. And then I'll hear a sniffle, and I'm like, oh, thank you, God. You're hitting the heart, you know. So that's just being honest. Sometimes I know really strongly this is the interpretation. Other times I'm going, and you hear that sniffle, and you're like, yes, thank you, Jesus. We are on track. I think we're going somewhere. It's hit them deep, you know.
You're not trying to make people cry.
Yeah, no. No, I can't make people cry unless I, you know, stomp on their foot or something. That's about my strategy. But when you think about it, whenever God's spoken deeply to your heart, sometimes
sure.
you laugh, sometimes you cry. It's really powerful.
Marty just said, yes, our president holds prayer and has Christian advisors, some of whom are prophetic. Lance Wallnau has been there.
That's right.
I forgot about Lance Wallnau being there, but he's...
That's right. Yeah, he's the one that said, you're like Osiris. And he said all that when he wasn't planning to. So these are days of being stretched, my friends. Just... Yeah, it just is what it is. And I read that in the Bible today, but I don't know where it is. It's in my new translation. The Passion Translation is on BibleGateway.com. So I encourage you, if you're reading something in the Bible with the New Testament. He has Song of Solomon, Psalms and Proverbs, and the New Testament, and I'm in Revelation. That's where I keep going back to. I only understand like a little bit of the first couple of chapters and some of the last, but I am jumping with both feet. But what's powerful, when you read his translation, and then, I don't know if they have this in Bible Gateway, but if they have the notes at the end, he lists, this is a metaphor for this. This symbolizes that. So, yeah, I encourage you, you know, if you have a daily reading where it says, you know, Matthew 25, flip on Bible Gateway and read it in the Passion Translation. There's been some really cool things in there.
Okay.
It's the translation that has really unveiled things to me. I would compare it to, like, in the early, late 90s, early 2000s, I got the Spirit-Filled Life Bible, and it really opened a lot. It had the Hebrew and Greek and expanded things, and so that really was a powerful Bible with its notes. But this one is really good for unveiling things of what God wants to speak right now. So there's my plug for the Passion Translation.
All right.
Okay. I don't remember where it was. Oh, major life decisions should not be based only on a dream. If you're moving, or had a job change, or dream about who you're going to marry, just halt. Stop right there. Wait for confirmation, and God will bring it. Don't add your personal bias or experiences to another person's dream. Don't say more than the dream is saying. These are just things, but no, God's grace covers all of this. How to grow in your ability to interpret dreams. Practice, practice, practice. Just hit it face on. And when you don't feel like interpreting dreams, that's when you send out to your family and friends, hey, have you dreamed lately? Just stretch yourself. Just put yourself on the line and say, man, I don't want to do this, but Lord, I do want to do this, make the right declaration. But practice and just invite people. Say, I'm practicing interpreting dreams. You know, have you dreamed? Are you a dreamer? Let me know. And you can always send the dream to dreamerslive411@gmail.com if you get stuck on an interpretation or if you want help. And because you're in class, I will say, what do you have so far? So let me know what you have so far on the dream. And by the way, I went over that dream you sent me with the interpretation, so I ran out of time today, but I will get back to you with what I saw in it. So,
was I anywhere?
Well, you know what? I just decided I wasn't going to look at your interpretation. I was just going to read it over, do mine, and then compare. So I haven't done that yet either. I wanted to. There's so many good dreams. I just wanted to do them all today, and I ran out of time. So.
Marty added, another one of my prophetic mentors also works with national leaders at D.C. and in other nations. I'm excited at how God is placing strong people of faith into influential positions.
Yes. Thank you, God. That is so encouraging. Isn't that encouraging?
Yeah.
Yeah, for such a time as this, it's kind of Esther moments, isn't it? God's positioning people. So it means he's up to something.
Like every morning you get up and jump on the news real quick because you can just see God moving. It's like a chessboard.
Yes.
Like you said, everybody's being moved. Thank you. I just love it. I get so excited.
Me too. Yeah, it's really a great time to be
there. The church is like,
yay!
Taking off.
Wow. There's
especially
so many.
In the Middle East where you can take.
Oh, when you said the underground church, I imagine China. But the Middle East, wow. Wow. Yes, Lord, bless it. We agree. That is so cool.
All over the world. It's just amazing what he's doing.
I know, and I get a little overwhelmed when I have, you know, two things scheduled on one day. God's doing the whole world, you know. It's so cool.
He already said he's bigger.
He is. I know. It just blows my mind. It's like, some of that. I need some more of that, Lord. More. Okay, how to grow. Memorize the top 20 dreams. Anyone done that yet?
More.
That's a challenge.
Together as a team we did.
That's right.
Yes.
We have the mind of Christ and we're all combining our minds to get the top 20s. I like that. Okay, value dreams. Write them down. Daniel 7:1 talks about he had the dream and he wrote it down. Steward them well. That means seek God for the interpretation. If there's verses and declarations that come out of it, pray into it and come into agreement with it. If it's a nightmare, flip it and just take your Christmas list, like I said, and declare it. But respond to the dream. When God gives it to you, respond to it, which is often through prayer. Just dialogue with God. My goodness, I just need an interpreter for myself. just talk to God about it. How about I use talk instead of dialogue? And he, like I said, he wants to be in that relationship, and don't make me laugh. Okay, we might have to just go to break. All right, so we'll be back in 10 minutes because I'm starting to cry. So.